Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of the broadcast. I'm your host, Josh Reeves. This is Tuesday, October the 1st, 2019. Another year has almost completely passed us by. It's unbelievable how fast time has accelerated over the past couple of years. I know they say that's just getting old or whatever have you, but I tend to think there's more to it than just that. I don't know. I don't have all the answers, but I think there's something bigger than just, oh, you're getting old, so time goes by faster. Nah, I don't believe that. I think there's something that happened over the past several years. I don't know whether it was CERN or whatever it might be, but I don't know, something. I was like, you remember where there was that earthquake or something, and it said that knocked Earth off its axis and sped up time? Was it an earthquake or was it a tsunami or something like that? I can't remember. Something like that. Anyway, regardless, glad to be with you here for another show tonight. I'll be honest with you, I'm not feeling well today at all. So I'll give you as much as I can for as long as I can tonight until I can't do anymore because I'm just not feeling well and I need to rest and recoup and all that so I can get back to the work at hand here with the films and whatnot. But again, thanks for joining me. Thanks for being here. Update on our fundraising efforts for the month. We are pretty much still where we were yesterday. We didn't get anything in really significant today, which is a problem. I've got this push until tomorrow, but past that, I don't have any more time left. So we need to get everybody in to contribute, all the procrastinators and all the people that have not contributed anything yet. We only got like $800 to go. So as long as we can get that in here in the next 24 hours, by like 5 o'clock on Wednesday, we'll be good. So everybody contribute, everybody pitch in so we can continue and I can stay focused on the work at hand. Still got a little time left to get yourself one of those download box sets too for $120 from the download shop. If you hadn't hit that yet, do that too. Okay, I'm just going to jump right into the news and go for as long as I can tonight because, like I said, I'm not feeling well and don't have a lot of energy to do this. So, nervous Kremlin warns U.S. against releasing transcripts of Trump's calls with Putin. A Kremlin official warned Friday that any release of transcripts of phone calls between Donald Trump and Russian President Vladimir Putin could exacerbate problems that already exist between the nations. So this is the shit I've been talking about. That's what they don't want anybody to find out. They don't want anybody to find out their scam. They don't want anybody to find out that American politics, and to this point, almost, you know, I mean, they've been controlling, Russia has been controlling talking points in America politically and otherwise for almost two decades. And that's a big thing that they're scared of coming out, is that, you know, the Russian president, the Russian government's completely mob run. You got factions on the left, factions on the right. And like I said before, all this works well and fine. It's one of the things that the Democrats got to be careful of what they're fucking with here. Because these guys are fucking nuts. And the way you're going to end up seeing World War III is the day when Russia basically doesn't have power over us anymore. That's the only thing that's staving off. When they get to the point where their power wanes and their control over America wanes, that's when they're going to launch the missiles. We would like to hope that things won't come to such situations in our bilateral relations, which already have plenty of quite serious problems. This is a rather unusual practice. As a rule, the materials from conversations on the level of the head of state are considered secret or top secret. Peskov was responding to a question about the Kremlin's reaction to the White House decision to release a summary of the controversial July 25th call between Trump and the Ukrainian president. Trump's repeated requests in the call to Zelensky to launch an investigation into his political rival Joe Biden and his son are now the target of an impeachment inquiry, which, again, as I talked about last time, is weak. That's so weak. This kind of shit goes on all the time in every country with every leader. It's total fucking weak sauce. And it's a total distraction. It's a 100% distraction. And my question is, what are they going to do in response to this to distract from this? Because as I'm sure a lot of you probably already noticed, we've been on this sort of train of, you know, they have one operation, they do one thing. And then to distract attention away from that, when people start getting too knowledgeable, they do something else, and then people forget about what happened before. Could it be the staged alien invasion card? Could they be getting ready to play that? It's possible. Have you noticed, though, all of a sudden, since all this started happening, speech and talk happened, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, she was living under a rock, nobody seen her fucking hurt her stupid face and mouth, and now all of a sudden, Hillary Clinton's on a fucking media run, she's on all the fucking shows, and oh, Jesus. They really aren't that fucking stupid, are they? Y'all don't really think, y'all aren't really going to play the fucking Hillary card again, are you? I mean, give me a fucking break. That's your solution, Democrats? That's your fucking Trump card, no pun intended? Oh, we got him now. Roll Hillary out. Please. But what they're banking on is they're banking on, well, hey, who else is better? They're banking on the lesser of the evils argument. But to me, it just still goes back to the original argument that South Park put out before the last election. The, you know, the turd sandwich versus the giant douche. It doesn't matter which one you pick, you're getting shit either way. Now, this is another interesting article, more proof of what I've already told you about, what I've been telling you about for years with Russia. Russians use greed to capture NRA, Senator alleges in new report. Surprise, surprise, the CIA-controlled and CMP-controlled, in case you don't know, all the top guys in the NRA are all not only CIA-connected, but Council for National Policy members as well. So, on top of everything we already know, now we're finding out that just like the CMP and other groups, the National Rifle Association is in the pocket of the Russians. And I'm sure they'll just say this is a left-wing conspiracy theory, but it's not. Ties between the National Rifle Association and influential Russians were substantial. By the way, this also ties into that movie, The Family, I told you about. It's on Netflix. You haven't seen that, watch that documentary. Ties between the National Rifle Association and influential Russians were substantial and potentially lucrative enough to render the politically potent gun lobby an asset of Russia, according to a state Democrats year-plus investigation. I could have told you this. But see, that's the problem. The people looking into this, and you have these corrupt fucking phony asshat Democrats are pulling this out, and then it comes out from a Democrat, and then people who really need this information and can use it just ignore it because it becomes a political thing. That's why you're never going to fully grasp or get the truth if you are still participating in the phony left-right political paradigm. Because you're going to ignore facts and ignore things you need to know because it's coming from whatever the opposite team is that you're against. You know, it's like football teams. If you're, I think of a team, New England Patriots. If you're a New England Patriots fan and you're a diehard fan, and I don't even know who their biggest fucking rival is because I don't give a shit about football or the AFC specifically. I don't even know who is the fucking. I don't even know. I mean, they win everything every year. So do they even have any big rivals? I don't know. But do you really think that the New England Patriots give a shit if, you know, their rival team is knowledgeable at calling plays and is knowledgeable at football? Do you think it matters to them? Do you think they care? No, fuck no. It's the same thing here. You know, that's the enemy. I don't give a fuck if they're smart at certain things or whatever. They're the enemy. We got to defeat them, right? But that's ignorant, because you could sit back and say, look, you know, all right, that's the enemy, but what can we learn from? If you can learn and, you know, learn tactics and learn how to combat your enemy by knowing them. More than 4,000 pages of NRA records provided to Senator Ron Wyden, the top Democrat on the Finance Committee, documented deep connections between the beleaguered gun group and Maria Butina, who in December pleaded guilty to conspiring to act as a Russian agent without registering with the Justice Department. Wyden's report, released Friday and undertaken without the cooperation of committee Republicans, indicates that greed motivated some NRA officials to engage in the outreach. Butina also made clear to NRA officials long before their controversial Butina-facilitated December 2015 trip to Moscow that Alexander Torshin, her patron and ally of Russian President Vladimir Putin, was a man with mysterious pull in the Kremlin. She emailed former NRA President David Keene in January 2015 that Torshin's appointment to the Russian Central Bank was, quote, the result of a big game in which he has a very important role. All the details we can discuss with you only in person. During the 2016 election, Russian nationals effectively used the promise of lucrative personal business opportunities to capture the NRA and gain access to the American political system. Representatives for the NRA did not immediately respond to comment, of course not. In addition to scrutinizing the December 2015 NRA trip, Wyden found the NRA hosted former Russian Ambassador Sergei Kislyak for a three-hour tour of its headquarters in August 2015. Kislyak was a key figure in Russia's 2016 election interference before former National Security Advisor Mike Flynn pleaded guilty to misrepresenting his conversations with him to the FBI. An NRA calendar entry provided to Wyden suggests that NRA leaders took Kislyak to hunting at the Grand National Waterfowl Hunt weeks before the Moscow trip. Wyden's report shows that the NRA officials, donors, and supporters meeting with Russian officials under the U.S. sanctions during the Moscow trip, something previously reported, but it also shows that Butina ensured the NRA would send sufficiently senior leaders, something necessary to enhance Torshin's prestige by dangling opportunities for NRA luminaries to enrich themselves, while U.S. sanctions do not make meetings of foreigners under sanction illegal. U.S. nationals cannot conduct business with them. So this is a fascinating piece of information, but unfortunately, because, like I said, because it's being brought, but who it's being brought out by, it's going to largely be ignored and seen as part of this witch hunt. And again, this is how they're keeping the whole phony political thing going. You got, because it's so ridiculous, and everybody on both sides is so ridiculous, and nobody knows what to believe, and so they'd rather just stick to their side than stick to the facts. This is fascinating. This is this goes back to some of the stuff I told you about a while back, about a month or so ago, pertaining to the stuff with Vladislav Doronin that I uncovered, the connections to Epstein and Naomi Campbell and the whole, you know, how the connections into the UFC, the mafia connections into UFC. I talked about Colby Chaos Covington wearing the MAGA hat and having all the Trump sons at his ring and stuff. And obviously we talked about the Russian connections with MMA and how they use these guys for private security for these big mobsters in Russia. I never saw this when it came out. It came out in October 2016, so it came out right before Trump was elected. Fascinating article. Donald Trump's failed foray into the world of MMA. By now, most people recognize the key pages in the Donald Trump playbook. An ambitious effort starts with a bang but ends with the rumor of a whimper tucked deep inside classified legal briefs well clear of the camera's eye. The sports world has not gone unscathed. Trump's ill-fated involvement with the United States Football League ended in a pungent stew of red tape and bad feelings and is the stuff of sports business infamy. Speaking to Esquire about the debacle, Charlie Steiner, radio voice of the USFL's Trump-owned New Jersey Generals and current play-by-play man for the Los Angeles Dodgers, said of Trump, quote, "You can cut and paste the USFL and the GOP, and it's the same damn story. It's all about him and the brand moving on to the next thing if it doesn't work out." The USFL is the splashiest sports example, but it's not, to coin a phrase, the Trumpiest. For that, you'd have to go back to the sport of mixed martial arts, where he and his organization's intimate, aggressive involvement wove a very recognizable pattern. Crack open that nesting doll and you'll find Trump's dealings with Affliction Entertainment. Although it holds a lower profile than the USFL, for example, it's still the best sports illustration of Trump's modus operandi. But let's back up a few years. In point of fact, Trump does have deep roots in the MMA community. In MMA's early days, his backing may have staved off the sport's demise. Now that's fascinating. That's the main key here. Apparently, UFC was going under, and Dana White's whole well-documented, basically saving the sport in 2001 when he took over, happened because of Trump's money. So again, more evidence to what I've told you about previously, with Russia, the Russian mob, the UFC, etc. In 2001, when UFC 1 was only 8 years old, MMA was in the eyes of many a novelty or worse. The UFC had been sold to Zuffa, a company owned by Las Vegas casino heirs Frank and Lorenzo Fertitta and their friend Dana White. At that point, many major markets and media had turned their collective back to the UFC, forcing the promotion to stage untelevised cards in third-tier civic centers. Trump broke with that custom, however, and welcomed the UFC with open arms. He offered Trump Taj Mahal in Atlantic City, New Jersey, a major step up in location and prestige as a potential host location. The new owners took him up on this offer, and the Trump Taj hosted UFC 30 and UFC 31 that year. The venue also hosted UFC 28, the final event staged by previous UFC owners SEG. White never forgot the gesture and reciprocated with unconditional loyalty, culminating with his bellowed endorsement of Trump on primetime TV at July's Republican National Convention. Quote, "Arenas around the world refused to host our events. Nobody took us seriously. Nobody, except Donald Trump. Donald was the first guy that recognized the potential that we saw in the UFC and encouraged us to build our business. He hosted our first two events at his venue. He dealt with us personally. He got in the trenches with us, and he made a deal that worked for everyone. On top of that, he showed up for the fight on Saturday night and sat in the front row. Donald championed the UFC before it was popular, before it grew into a successful business. And I'll always be so grateful to him for standing with us in those early days. So tonight, I stand with Donald Trump." Clearly, the relationship held special meaning for White. That context only makes it more interesting to recall that Trump's deepest dive into MMA came with a company that was at the time hell-bent on taking down the UFC. In 2008, Affliction Clothing, a manufacturer of MMA apparel based in Seal Beach, California, decided to stage a rare and brazen challenge to the UFC's dominance. Affliction Entertainment was formed as a separate company to stage pay-per-views with the ambition of cutting into the UFC's revenue pile. Seeking the biggest possible splash, Affliction execs threw a mountain of money and every other shiny thing they could find at a Russian heavyweight great, Fedor Emelianenko, a long a UFC white whale and ex-UFC champ, Tim Sylvia. According to MMA Junkie, the former reportedly received $300,000 per bout, while the latter received $800,000. Even 8 years later, extremely handsome sums for MMA fighters. But Affliction's biggest flourish arguably came from a little deal it struck with a man named Donald Trump. Just ask Trump himself. There was something tremendous in the air. "It's really something that I'm doing because I really enjoy doing it," Trump told reporters during a Trump Tower news conference for Affliction Entertainment. "If we make money, that's great. I think we will. I think it will be successful. What I do is usually successful." In the same news conference, Trump flashed the same brand of media awareness that has characterized his political career. I seem to get a lot of attention. For instance, if I wasn't here today, you might have maybe one rider. Now the place is packed. According to some people, the partnership was purely cosmetic. Trump lent his face and name to a photo op and press conference. They brought in Donald Trump for name value. They use his name for publicity, which happens a lot with Trump. But if you're in the dicey business of reading Trump's tea leaves, it could have been more than window dressing. Trump declared he had bought a significant stake in the company, which would allow the upstart promotion to pursue and retain roster talent. But it's not a very big deal for me, he said. When you build a billion-dollar building like I'm doing in Dubai and lots of other places, that's a much bigger financial commitment. This goes on and on, but really the long and the short of it is, a lot of these guys have been, I'm trying to think of the other names of the other MMA organizations. I know there's Bellator. Bellator's owned by fucking Viacom, Sumner Redstone, that's CIA all the way to the fucking bank. There was another one that was owned by the Yakuza. I mean, the mafia and organized crime, as well as Freemasons, have been balls deep in MMA for a long time. But, that said, it's still entertaining. I mean, it's still better than watching fucking football. You know, even though, there are elements of the UFC stuff that's staged. But, the who people fight and all that, it's determined way before they ever announce it. You know, somebody fights. The most recent example, I guess, for a big fight that's coming up is the Jorge Masvidal versus Nate Diaz fight that's coming up later in the year. And Nate Diaz had not fought in a month or two ago. He came back, fought for the first time in a few years. And this was just after Masvidal had done his fucking, world record knockout, flying knee knockout in like 3 seconds, the first round. Fastest knockout in UFC history. And then when the Nate Diaz fight comes around, they just conveniently happen to have, out of all the fighters they could have had, they happen to have Jorge Masvidal in the crowd. And then what does Nate Diaz do when it's over? He challenges Jorge Masvidal. They talk about, let's find out who the baddest motherfucker alive is. Dana says, okay, I'll make a $50,000 belt for it. You think that just happens? I mean, all that shit was planned out well in advance. The fighting and all that, now they really do fuck each other up. Now, I'll give them that. But as far as like, I've seen so much chicanery. I see it all the time. You can watch any UFC on any given week, and in at least 1 to 2 rounds, you will see. Because it's all professional sports is all controlled by the betting. It's all scams based on betting. And the casinos and the people who run the casinos, we know casinos have largely been traditionally run by organized crime. These are the people that control organized sports, and they control the betting, and they also control the refs and the judges. But, they are really beating the shit out of each other. It's just, it's a controlled environment, and it's not nearly as real. It's, there's still an element of like what you see stage stuff in wrestling and stuff that goes on within the UFC. But athletically, though, I think the people who participate in it are much more impressive athletes, because you have to be, it's like if you're a football player, all you got to do is be good at football. You got one job. That's all you got to do. At least in MMA, you've got to be, in order to be a champion, you basically have to become an expert in like 4 or 5 different disciplines of martial arts. You had to be good at grappling, wrestling. You had to have strong grappling and wrestling skills. Kickboxing, Muay Thai, Jiu-Jitsu, Taekwondo, boxing. The real people who become the top tier athletes in the sport, it's not just, you're a baseball player, you hit a ball and you fucking run, you catch it, that's it. And there's all kinds of, you know, juiced up shit. Anyway, regardless of that, let's move on. Kanye West IMAX reveal exclusive movie collaboration. If you haven't seen Mystery Hollywood, you need to go back and watch that. I told you the stuff that I uncovered in that film was groundbreaking. I uncovered stuff that ties in with the, this secret ascension cult that I told you the end of last year, beginning of this year, Kanye was involved in. And what have we seen since then? We've seen, this is before he started having the Sunday service stuff. And now we see, and then I covered that, the first Sunday service thing. Remember that? And he just happened to have a whole bunch of fucking MK Ultra clowns out there with him, Courtney Love and fucking, what's her tits? Katy Perry. Who, as I showed you in that Nardwar video I made, clearly another MK Ultra victim. Katie size queen Perry. Poor girl. She probably was probably getting the dick stuck to her when she was 14 or 15 or something under mind control. So now the poor girl just, you know, she can't even be with you if you don't have a fucking elephant trunk down there between your legs. That's why she went back to John Mayer so many times. You know that about John Mayer, right? Yeah, John Mayer's got a legendary schwanz. Oh yeah, legendary song. Supposedly that dude's packing a goddamn fucking woolly mammoth trunk between his legs. 19 inches of fucking thick meat. And he laid it on fucking what's her fucking kind what's her name? The reptilian queen. Taylor Swift. He laid it on her and she wrote a song about him. And then Katy Perry liked it so much, she was off and on again with him a few times. And then she got with Orlando Bloom, who she's engaged to now. And everybody was like, Orlando Bloom? I mean, he's not a musician. You know, some chicks think he's hot, but, you know, why is she getting with him? And then these pictures came out of them, like, paddleboarding. And they're, like, in some paddleboard or paddleboat or something. On a river somewhere out in the middle of nowhere. And I guess somebody just happened, paparazzi happened to fucking follow and be there too, out in the middle of fucking who knows where. And they're like paddling. He's standing up fully nude, Orlando Bloom. And Katy Perry's in it with him and he's standing up and he's just got his fucking kielbasa fucking hanging out. And you're like, okay. All right. I get it now. All right. Yeah. I was wondering why she's with him. John Mayer, though, on the flip side of this, I don't know if you guys know about this. A lot of people don't know this. It's not been widely reported. John Mayer's gay now. Did you know that? John Mayer's fucking gay now. It's not a rich fact. John Mayer's gay now. Now, good luck finding that on the internet. You might find some. Yeah, there was photos of him coming out of multiple gay bars with another celebrity that's known to be gay and all this stuff. Hey, whatever, man. But it's just funny to me because that dude was Mr. Ass Getter. In Hollywood and music, that dude got so much puss. Think about this. Think about it. John Mayer slayed so much ass. He don't even want pussy anymore. Can you imagine? Must be nice, huh? That dude slayed so much pussy, doesn't even interest him anymore. He's done with it. Jesus Christ. How much pussy have you gotten where you don't even interest him anymore? Don't even interest him anymore. Don't even want it. Man ass is more appealing to him now, which is interesting. Of course, you know, when I talked about in that lost episode, remember when I talked about the stuff with Chappelle and the gay stuff with Chappelle and the stuff about Paul Mooney and all that gay stuff going on? I speculated Well, you know that's another buddy of Chappelle's, right? John Mayer, I mean, he was on Chappelle's show. He's been in his comedy specials. He's done tours and done shows with him before. They're big buddies. And now it comes out he's gay and he likes the butt stuff. So now Hollywood, I guess, is getting in bed with even more with, I don't know what's going on here. I rebooted my computer before I started. I'm getting all kinds of crackling. here, which you're probably going to hear in the audio. I apologize. I'll get this fixed for the next show. There's nothing I can do about it now because I'm already recording. So they're making like a Hollywood IMAX movie with his fucking Sunday Service shit in it. It's showing it in an IMAX. I mean, if this doesn't fucking confirm even more for what I told you about in the Mystery Hollywood series, I don't know what does. The film set for an October 25th release will include music from West's new album, Jesus is King. IMAX on Saturday revealed a collaboration with Kanye West in which they will release the film Jesus is King exclusively in IMAX theaters around the world on October 25th. Filmed in the summer of 2019, Jesus is King brings Kanye West's famed Sunday Service to life in the Rodin Crater. Visionary artist James Turrell's never-before-seen installation in Arizona's Painted Desert, IMAX said in a statement, this one-of-a-kind experience features songs arranged by West and the gospel tradition along with music from his new album, Jesus is King, all presented in the immersive sound and stunning clarity of IMAX. I mean, this is fucking ridiculous. And I mean, it's some serious Ascension cult shit right here. And I predict that and I could be wrong about this. I hope I'm wrong about this. This is one of those predictions I hope I'm absolutely, positively wrong about. And that I missed the mark widely on this. But, I mean, I really hope this completely fails and nobody buys into it and he goes back to the fucking hole he crawled out from. Probably Trump's asshole, I think. I predict that that his Ascension cult, the Kanye Ascension cult thing, I think that it has the potential. I think it has the potential to overtake Scientology and other New Age religions within Hollywood as the major religion that Hollywood types and whatnot and people in the music industry follow. I really believe that. Now, again, I hope I'm 100% absolutely wrong about that. I hope that doesn't come true, but I think it has the potential to. And it's just so fascinating how I stumbled upon that when I was dissecting that movie Under the Silver Lake and the whole Ascension cult thing in there and discovery of that video game with all the hidden Ascension cult stuff. You got to see Mystery Hollywood, dude. You just got to see that 5-part series. You can get all 5 parts for a discount, $40 in one pack out of the download shop. Go do it now. 5 earthquakes in less than an hour rattle southeast Missouri, experts say. This clicking pop is driving me nuts. There's no reason she'd be doing this. I don't know what's going on. They're fucking sabotaging my shit again. Everything's tip-top. I restarted the computer. I did everything that you need to do. I don't know what's happening with this. It never fucking happens until I'm getting into certain info. An area of southeast Missouri experienced 5 earthquakes in less than an hour Monday. It started with a 2.6 magnitude trembler around 11:18 a.m. near Lilburn, a small city just north of Missouri's Boot Heel. According to the United States Geological Survey, a mere 3 minutes later, a 1.1 magnitude quake rumbled nearby just before 11:30 a.m. A 2.7 magnitude quake rattled somewhere, blah, blah, blah. Listen, I've talked about this before. Everybody always wants to talk about when's the big one going to hit California? When's the big one going to hit San Andreas? When's California going to fall into the fucking ocean? Escape from LA style. And yet, very few people have been talking about or do talk about the New Madrid. The possibility of the New Madrid fault system going into play. It has before. I believe it was Edgar Cayce talked about the New Madrid stuff. I've talked about it in the past, too. It apparently made the Mississippi River run backwards for a period of time and all this stuff. Essentially, if this thing goes off, it's going to cause, the damage is going to cause a loss of millions upon millions of lives, and it's going to cause a crater to form basically right in the middle of the United States in which all the water from the Great Lakes will drain into. So it'll be just like a giant lake ocean crater in the middle of the United States. And this has been predicted to have been coming in our time for many, many years. And I think it's been largely ignored, but I think there's something to it. And I've got another story we'll get into here in a little bit. We've had earthquake swarms here in Texas, too. Archaeologists stunned after unearthing 3,000-year-old penis statue used by a cult. The girthy penis is 21 inches tall. I don't know what to say other than I told you so. I told you this. I talked about this back when I was doing Lost Secrets of Ancient America stuff. People laughed at me, and people thought I was joking around, and it is funny. And I did say it in a comedic way, but I'm being serious. People are going to have to get comfortable with the fact that our ancestors and the people that seeded society were cock-worshipping obelisk builders. That's what they were. This is probably built by the Amorites. The Amorites were the original obelisk builders. And they worship Kak. It's like fucking, what's his name? The comedian used to talk about. Carlin. Now, all fucking wars are based on dicks. What? They have bigger dicks? Bomb them. And the bombs and the bullets and the rockets are all shaped like dicks. Once again, he was right, you know. This is interesting. I don't know if you guys remember back when, a few years ago, back when the actor Paul Walker died in a car wreck. And I said from the very beginning that I thought that he was assassinated, murdered. It's interesting, things have come out since then. And I'm just as convinced now as I was then that I think the footage conclusively, I think that car was hit by some kind of drone strike, and I think it was done by Russia. You know, what's interesting is that in the time before his death, did you know that Paul Walker was dating a 16-year-old girl? And nobody said anything about it. He was like a friend of his daughter's or something. Openly. He was openly dating a 16-year-old girl. And nothing came of it. But he was also... Go look it up. Type Paul Walker, chemical weapons. He was working to, well, I believe he was working for the abolishment of chemical weapons. Now, wait a minute. That wasn't somebody else, was it? Let me double check this. No, never mind. No, he wasn't. Totally different person. Okay. Yeah, I got bad intel on that. I apologize. I'm glad I caught it. Okay, so the Paul Walker that was working. Okay, never mind. Changed my tune. Forget I said that. Regardless, though, he was dating a 16-year-old. That's true. That much is true. All right. Bad intel. That's what I get for listening to people. Every time that somebody sends me shit, it turns out to be fake, bunk, disinfo. I'm just got to quit. I mean, I hate to have to do it, but for the most part, those of you that send me shit from now on, I'm just going to ignore. I can't keep doing this. You guys are fucking sending me bunk shit that sounds legit, and then I don't check it out, and that happens. But yeah, here it is. Here's that story. When are we going to address how Paul Walker had relationships with underage girls? My thing about this was I thought possibly maybe he was, you know, he was dating underage girls, and maybe he had some connection to Russian sex trafficking, and maybe he was getting ready to come out about it, and that's why they offed him, but I don't know. I think he was just a perv. Listen, everybody likes tight pussy, dude, but why don't you wait till they turn 18? You can't wait till they turn 18? I don't get that. Especially these sugar daddies. Fucking, you know, get them when they're 16, don't have any sex with them, fucking, you know, prop them up, and then group, you know, I'm not endorsing that or saying you should do that. I'm just saying, I don't understand why you can't wait till they're 18. Wait till they're legal, then have sex with them. Jesus. What else? Old fucking Freemason boy is at it again. You know, I gotta say, I'm one of the world's foremost experts on Freemasonry. I've been told by Freemasons that there are people who have, you know, all the degrees, and I know actually more about Mason than most Masons do. I've been told that. But I got to tell you, man, at every turn, these fuckers come up. Every turn, at everything I've ever researched, they come up. I'm doing the CMP research when I first started doing that 12 years ago. What do I keep finding in that? I keep finding all these people, Chuck Missler and fucking Rich DeVos. You know, the Amway guy, owner of the Orlando Magic basketball team. And then I start getting into the rock wall stuff, start doing that research. I'm like, oh, I'll finally get away from this bullshit. And I start getting into that, and lo and behold, what do I find? Who's the main person that's been active in the cover-up of the rock wall? Congressman Ralph Hall. He's also a Freemason. You know, the first person that actually declared the rock wall was a man-made structure was a Mason, because they recognized the Masonic handiwork in it. That's why the town got named Rockwall in the first place, because everybody that moved there and staked claims wanted to name it after themselves, Johnsonville and Dickville or whatever they want to call it. They unearthed the wall for the first time. The local Masons came, inspected it, and said, boys, you're all out of luck, because none of you were the first ones here. This proves there were people here long before us. And not only does it prove that, it proves they're one of us, the Masons, because this is Masonic handiwork. You can see, they can see the mathematics and the Masonic mathematics into the building of that wall. And that's why the town became named Rockwall. On and on and on. Every bit of every investigation I've ever done, it always leads back to the Freemasons. I told you years ago, even before he was getting any heat with this UFO shit, I told you, man, people said I was crazy. You can go look at the pictures. I posted them on Facebook a couple of weeks ago. Tom DeLonge, Blink-182, the guy's a Freemason. He's been a Freemason since they were selling records. He's got Masonic square and compasses on his fucking guitar neck. By the way, I do think it's hilarious, though. If you go look at the pictures, you can type Tom DeLonge Freemason into Google Images and see everything. You can see him standing there with a Masonic nut ragged jobulon on. You know, he's wearing it. What is funny is he's standing next to the brothers. I think this is what happened. He's such a douchebag. None of the other rights would take him in. He had to go Prince Hall. Prince Hall, if you don't know, Prince Hall is a largely black element of Freemasonry that's really only takes, for the most part, black initiates. But it's not a racist thing. It was actually formed by African-Americans as their own branch of Freemasonry. It's not, okay, if you're black, you got to go here. No, that's not true. And I know that's not true, because I knew a guy several years ago, a drummer here in Dallas, a black guy, and he's a Freemason, and he's not Prince Hall. I think he's Yorkrite or something like that. But one night I was at a gig, and there was a guy, like a security guy that had a Freemason shirt on, square and compass on. He goes, hey, Josh, watch this. I was like, what? What are you going to do? He's like, watch this. And he goes up to the fucking guy, my friend, the black guy, the drummer, the Freemason, goes up to the guy. Hey, man, he's like slapping the fucking gang hands shakes on him, the fucking Masonic shakes. And, you know, and the guy was doing it back to him. I was losing. It was hilarious. He's like, watch this. And, but no, you don't have to, but, and also with Prince Hall Masonry, you don't necessarily, yes, it was created by blacks, but I think in some instances they will take whites. I just think it's hilarious. And, well, the picture you see with Tom DeLonge wearing the nut ragged jobulon, he's standing over there with the brothers. Only the brothers would take him. Because I'm not going to discriminate. They've been discriminated against their whole lives. They'll take the white boy in, even nobody else wants him. That's just fucking hilarious. Alien hunters led by Blink-182 singer say they have found exotic material that's debris from a spacecraft. A month after the group revealed a video featuring UFOs that the U.S. Navy likely confirmed is real. Again, this is all a part of the deception, ladies and gentlemen. This is all a part of the staged alien invasion scenario. This is all a part of this, and the disinfo people and the liars in the you know, conspiracy and whatever else crowds you want to call it, UFO crowds, they are ramping it up right now. And it's just a big confusion thing. Because again, I've told you time and time again, of course I believe extraterrestrials exist. But if you believe that we've been lied to all these years about everything, and then one day extraterrestrials are going to reveal themselves to us, and then we're going to be told the truth about that, you're just deluding yourself. President Trump demanded his border wall get an alligator or snake-filled moat, and officials got an estimate of the cost. New book reveals he'll probably deny this, say it's fake news and everything. But regardless of whether or not, he also says he wanted to shoot illegal immigrants in the legs. I don't know about that, but I'm down with the, I'm down with the moat. That's fucking dope. It's fake news. I never said that. Whether he did or whether he didn't, that's a fucking good idea. I'm with it. I don't give a fuck who it pisses off. I'm with that. That's fucking badass. Hell fucking yeah. America. That's America right there. I'm with it. Fuck yeah. Show me where to sign on that. Fuck, I'll go down there. I fucking go down the border to see that. Fuck yeah. Come on to our country? You want to try to get here illegally? Good luck, bitch. Cross that fucking moat. We got alligators, electric eels, fucking venomous snakes, piranha. Just fill that sumbitch up with every goddamn nasty, gnarly, fucking 17-foot fucking boa constrictors and pythons. Oh, that'd be badass, wouldn't it? And then they should just put the live feeds, 24/7 live feeds, on a channel and charge $20 a month for it. I'm there. I'm in. I'll pay right now. Take my money. That'd be the shit. I don't give a fuck who this pisses off. I'm sorry. I don't care. I just don't care. This is a fucking badass idea. I'm with this. This is the coolest thing I've heard about in a while. I'm down. Fuck yeah. America. You want to come and get in our country illegally, motherfuckers? You're going to cross that moat. You cross that moat and you make it to the piranhas and the poisonous snakes and the fucking crocodiles and the fucking pythons. By God, you deserve to be here. Man, I want to see that, though. That'd be the shit. That's the best idea I've heard yet that Trump's allegedly come up with, whether he did or whether he didn't. I'm sure he'll say he didn't, but since this information is coming out in some book or something, but still, can you imagine a 2,000-mile border moat with the wall? Dude, fuck Fear Factor or any of those shows. Fuck, that's the show I want to see, dude. And you know what they should call that shit? Coming to America. That's what they should call that shit. Motherfuckers making it through with fucking limbs fucking hanging off and shit and fucking, oh, it was tough, but we made it. And fucking, oh, dude, fucking, oh, my daughter got eaten. No, you're tough. You make it through the fucking moat, you deserve to be here. As soon as you make it through that shit, you get citizenship. You don't even have to be illegal. You're getting citizenship immediately. If you make it through the fucking moat of death with the motherfucking pythons and fucking boa constrictors and snakes and alligators and, oh, that's the fucking, and 24/7 live stream coverage of that shit, $19.95 a month. Netflix will be put out of business in a month. I'm telling you right now. Streaming live 24/7 border cams of people trying to illegally cross through the fucking 2,000-mile moat filled with every gnarly fucking man-eating fucking animal you can envision. God damn, that makes my dick hard. That's the fucking greatest idea I've ever heard. That's better than any movie, any TV show. I don't give a fuck who's pisses off. I don't give a fuck who says I'm sick and sadistic or cruel. That's fucking badass, and you know it too. You just don't want to admit it to yourself. There's some of you sitting around going, oh, I can't believe you're saying that. That's terrible. Fuck you. Dig into your heart of hearts and think about it. You know you agree with me. You know you want to see that. You just don't want to say it out loud like many things I say. That's what I'm here to do. I'm here to say all the things that you think, but you don't want to admit to everybody. You know it's true, girl. You know it's true. Former InfoWars editor says staff laughed when he asked not to lie about Sandy Hook. I know exactly who this fucking guy is they're talking about. I used to get harassed by this guy on the regular when I first started my show. Clearly, just from the things that he said, and used to come in chat rooms and say, clearly the guy is CIA. And like I said before, I don't think you can disagree with me and say I'm crazy. I don't think Jones is being controlled by the same CIA people that he was before. I think the operations changed. That's not to say I don't think he's still got some connections to, to the top. But this is just further proof for me. Because, I had dealings with this guy, and I'll tell you right now, from all the dealings I have with this guy, I was convinced 10 years ago this guy was CIA. Rob Jacobson. A 13-year veteran of conspiracy website InfoWars said in a recent court deposition that he repeatedly attempted to warn staff not to spread obvious lies about the parents of Sandy Hook, only to be met with laughter and ridicule. Now, this is hilarious, because this guy used to be on board with every fucking thing Jones said. And then since Jones started getting heat about the Sandy Hook thing, then he cut bait. Now he's acting like he was laughed at, and this guy, I think 100%, I think Jones would probably agree with me. I think Jones would agree with me on this point, to be honest with you, but I think that Rob Jacobson guy is 100% was a CIA asset, a plant from the very beginning. Because that's when Jones really started to shift into the real disinfo stuff, was when that guy Rob Jacobson came on board. Because, see, I used to have a friend in Jones's operation. No shit. Kevin Smith, not fucking Clerks Kevin Smith. There's a guy named Kevin Smith, and he was Jones' producer, and I got to know him through the 9/11 Truth Movement stuff. He used to actually come up to our, he'd come up from Austin to Dallas and come to our 9/11 Truth stuff. Great guy. Really cool guy. He gave me a lot of inside intel at the time. He got fired by Jones later on, of course, but because he just, as usual, he just got to a point where Jones would tell him, hey, oh, you need to do this. And he's like, I'm not fucking doing that. You're crazy. But I mean, he told me in 2007, who knows what this number is now, but he told me in 2007 that Jones made $250,000 a month off of the phony bullshit CIA front sponsors that he had on his show. And that's 2007 numbers, folks. What do you think it's ballooned to since then? But that's why he has all his own stuff now. He's taken the Power Hour? He's taking their thing now, creating his own supplements and selling that whole thing. Anyway, this guy Jacobson, he's now turned on Jones. I knew he used to come and make threats. And when I was exposing Jones and CMP stuff, he used to come in our chat rooms and make threats and say shit like, oh, you're hurting. You're trying to hurt you're trying to make me not be able to feed my family and all the shit by exposing the CMP. I mean, this guy's a total CIA fucking asset. Are alien lurkers spying on us? Physicists suggest orbiting objects are stakeouts for Martian probes to observe life on Earth, and feeds into a 1960 theory that superior galactic communities are watching. Well, what about the Black Knight satellite? I believe that's the thing that they're most worried about. It's that this ancient fucking satellite that's been in geosynchronous orbit around the planet for thousands of years. Somebody's waiting for us to get to a certain point. And for whatever reason, I don't necessarily think they're waiting for us to get to a certain point so then they can come and wipe us out. But for whatever reason, we are being monitored. There's no question about that. James Benford released a paper suggesting that these ancient Martians, why do they always call them Martians? You had to be from Mars for them to be Martians, and there's no evidence that I get sick of the terminology. Plus, I don't feel good. I'm in a bad mood. I apologize. These co-orbital objects follow Earth's similar loop around the sun and do it very closely to our planet, providing the ideal way to watch our world from a secure natural object. What about the moon? No mention of that in your paper, huh, bud? No mention of that in this article, huh? Dumbass. I mean, if that was really going on, then there's no better candidate than the moon. But you don't bring that up? That tells me that that's probably what the truth is. Then. Talks about that in ancient Sumerian texts. How the Anunnaki were running Earth from a station up on the moon. Remember that movie, The Truman Show? And that's where that's where Ed Harris and the whole, the film crew that's filming his life that he thinks is his life, but it's actually a TV show. Where is it all run from? It's all run from what he believes to be the moon, but it's just, that's where the headquarters is. Yeah. Tom Cruise, listen to this. Jesus. Again, if this doesn't go along with what I told you in Spellcasters with the CIA and Scientology and all the rest of that, I don't know what does. Tom Cruise visits Ukrainian president while scouting film locations amid Donald Trump impeachment storm over phone call. Now, I've already documented Trump's connections to Scientology. I show those in the Spellcasters Volume 1.5 as well. All this is going on, and Tom Cruise just happens to go over to the Ukraine to scout movie locations. Bullshit. Bullshit. This is how the CIA does it. This is why they use Hollywood types for these type of operations. Because they can get in under the cover and the guise of doing stuff for Hollywood and movies, and meanwhile, behind the scenes and in secret, they're doing intel gathering or having secret meetings with leaders. That's what this is, folks. This is what I've been telling you. The Ukrainian president, who's at the center of Trump's impeachment scandal, wooed Tom Cruise at his lavish headquarters. Former actor turned politician. It's funny how that goes hand in hand, too, isn't it? Ronald Reagan? The actor? The Hollywood superstar is said to be studying possible Ukrainian locations for an upcoming film, right? But didn't say what film or what locations. Yeah, bullshit. It's got CIA written all over it. You guys ain't fooling fucking me. I can't get off the moat, the border moat. I just can't get off of it. It's all in my head. I can't get off of it. I'm fucking down with it. God damn, I want to see that. You think motherfuckers would be fucking around trying to come to our country illegally anymore? Hell no. You'd have some that would still try. Oh, I can make it. You can make it. Oh, I'll never get on Saturday Night Live after that comment, will I? I just can't get off it. I just can't. I'm sorry. I can't get off it. I don't give a fuck who it pisses off. That's fucking badass, dude. I want to see that shit. That's must-see TV right there. I want to see the moat. I want to see the fucking, just the nastiest fucking things y'all can fucking put it. Oh, that would be the shit. Anybody's going to come trying to fuck around getting America legally again? Bet not. Bet we nip that in the bud. See, this is why they could never make me president. Because they don't want somebody like me running the show with no fucks to give. Mystery object likened to the Death Star. Now, this is crazy because I just told you the story yesterday about that dream I had about the aliens projecting images of nuclear bombs going off around cities around the world that were just holograms and then projecting stuff like Imperial Star Destroyers and fucking Death Stars and shit in the sky. This is wild. Baffling footage of a circular object in the sky above New York City has been likened to the Death Star from Star Wars by stunned conspiracy theorists. I always love how they say, this has been done by conspiracy theorists. Yeah, they never give anybody's name. Who are these conspiracy theorists? We need to know their names. That's crazy. Again, I just think this is more of the same. I think this is more what we've already seen. I think this is more testing of the holographic technology that they're going to use to stage the fake alien invasion. Four earthquakes rattle Texas in less than 24 hours. We've had some earthquakes here in Dallas, which is not an earthquake area. We've had some over the past 10 years here. That was last year, year before. This is a couple of years ago. I was asleep. It was in the morning time. And my fucking bed levitated and shook for like 6 or 7 seconds. And I went, oh, nice. I got a full-blown poltergeist in my fucking house. This is great. Because I live in this old-ass fucking house. It's like 100 years old. So I was like, oh, great. I got a full... And then I looked later, and lo and behold, there was an earthquake at like the exact time not far from here. It was like 3.6 or something. I was like, okay, well, that's nice to know. You know, I feel better knowing that was an earthquake, not a goddamn poltergeist that fucking shook and levitated my bed for 7 seconds. Not kidding you. The bed lifted up off the ground. And I'm from Texas, man. I know you motherfuckers in other earthquake prone zones like California used to this shit, but I'm from Dallas, dude. We ain't used to having earthquakes down here. It's shit's freaky. But of course, we all know what the cause of that is. We don't have to go there. When or if NASA finds life on Mars, the world may not be ready for the discovery, the agency chief says. Here we go. I'm telling y'all, man, this is when the shit starts getting too deep with the Russia stuff or the impeachment stuff, that's when they're going to pull this card. Now, I could be wrong about this. Again, I hope I am. I want to be clear about that to people. I hope that of all the predictions I make, there's no joy in me being right about these things. There's not. I don't get off on it. It doesn't make me fucking feel powerful and all-knowing. It pisses me off. I hate being right. I'm tired of being right. I've been right about so many things, man, that I've said were coming that happened, and I don't like it. I don't like it at all. It doesn't give me any joy. But I'm telling you right now, this is coming. They're hinting at it big time. All the evidence is there that this is coming, and, they're still operating from that point of view, that antiquated, outdated 1950s, 1940s even point of view. And belief that if we tell Americans about the existence of extraterrestrials, we won't be able to control society, religions will crumble, societal structures will crumble, government will end up be total mass chaos. And I just don't believe that's the truth. But the solution to that is not to stage a fake alien invasion just so you can control the perimeters of it and keep people calm. That's bullshit. It's unbelievable. This is proof, they're still operating from that mindset. All right, folks, that's all I got for you tonight. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. We need all of your help. It's red alert. We got no time left. We have until 5 p.m. Central Standard Time on Wednesday to reach the rest of our goal. We got about 800 left, 8 people at $100 each, 1 person at 500, 1 person at 300, whatever. We need everybody pitching in everything you can so we can cover the operating costs and keep going and move on and get back to the work here, okay? I love you guys. We'll see you next time. Take care.